My name is Muhammad Fahmi, and I have experience in pediatric surgery for about 35 years. I am dedicated for the pediatric surgery from the start of my career immediately after qualification. I am a pediatric surgeon. Then in the last 15 years, I became more specialized with the genitourinary anomalies, and I have a high interest in the rare genitourinary anomalies. And for this purpose, I started to write books for Springer. I wrote 4 books about rare genitourinary anomalies, about congenital anomalies of the penis, about umbilicus and umbilical cord, prepuce normal and abnormal prepuce. And my 5th book will come in next month about normal and abnormal scrotum. I also authored a book for Elsevier about complications of male circumcision. And I have also experience with reconstruction of penile anomalies, or either it is an induced anomalies, for example, the complications of male circumcision, to reconstruct the penile appearance or the penile outlook for cases complicated after doing male circumcision, and for congenital anomalies like hypospadias, like other rare anomalies in the genitourinary tract. Today we will talk about the management of Prune-Billy syndrome. Actually, Prune-Billy syndrome is a group of anomalies, not a single anomaly. And it is mentioned by some authors that it is a triad syndrome, because the main triad of anomalies with Prune-Billy syndrome is abdominal musculature defect and urinary system abnormalities, and also bilateral undescended testicle. So it's called as a triad syndrome or Eagle Parrot syndrome, but this is not a common name. And sometimes it is called by some academics as abdominal musculation syndrome. This is one of the syndrome which is showing decline in incidence nowadays. The estimated incidence about 1 in 29,000 to 1 in 40,000 live births, and it is mainly with male, and 95% of the cases are male. And sometimes it is associated with other syndrome like Turner syndrome, monosmy syndrome, triosmy 13 and 18, and sometimes it is recorded with Pequot-Vedman syndrome. Most of the cases nowadays, actually, once we are talking globally, so my presentations will be for some doctors or some of the audience who are living in developing country with limited resources. So many cases presented late, but in Western country and in the United States, it is detected early. So in some countries, that's why they mentioned that the rate is declining, but it is not actually declining. The incidence is the same, but many cases detected intrauterine, and the mother had the option to do abortion early. So in many countries, some cases detected early, and once it is detected, the option of abortion is there. And also at the same time, in some European countries, many cases detected intrauterine with some fetal intervention, as we will talk later on. The pathogenesis is mainly obstruction of the urinary tract, and some claiming that the obstruction of the urinary tract is the sequence for the abdominal musculature. So abdominal musculature defect is secondary to the huge distension with ascites and with the huge distension of the bladder, because the most of the defect in the musculature of the urinary bladder with lower urinary tract obstruction, mainly posterior urethral valve and other associated anomalies. So this is subsequently result in oligohydramnios with pulmonary dysplasia. So many cases again will be delivered still pairs or delivered early as abortion, or the baby may be lost immediately after delivery. There is no facilities for lung support and pulmonary support, because many cases will die from pulmonary dysplasia and other cases will die from renal failure. Neonatal presentation, most of the cases will be presented in the neonate. Very difficult to have a case like the one we have in, on the right side with intact umbilical cord, but most of the cases, the umbilical cord itself had no support, musculature support. So you may lose the umbilical stump, or it's very difficult to catch a stump for the umbilicus to apply the clamp. And the, this foot in the left side is my first case I saw about 25 years ago. And the baby presented with absent umbilical cord, but actually the umbilical stump is cut flashly, or it is separated immediately from the abdominal wall with bleeding from the umbilicus. And sometimes some there is a leaking of the urine from the umbilical stump as a patent urethrus. So this is another case. It is the baby a little bit older. And if we concentrate in the umbilicus, we can find a drop of urine coming from the patent urethrus. This is another presentation in some countries which is, are not detecting these cases early in the enteral trial. In some other countries, you may have the baby not discovered, not diagnosed early, and you may have a child or infant with a typical appearance of the musculature. This is the Prune belly picture with a defect in the umbilicus itself. And most of the time, you will have the umbilical stump shifted more to the cephalic position than to the normal position in the mid side between the ziphus sternum and symphysis pubis. So, and the cardinal side is absent of post-testicle. Usually, it is a well-formed testicle, but it is bilaterally, abdominally, or intra-abdominally undescended testicle. This is the only case that I have a female child with incomplete picture, because actually Prune belly syndrome, as we mentioned, it's a wide spectrum of anomaly. So you may have a full blown picture of Prune belly syndrome, but in sometimes you may have just a limited defect in the musculature like this one. This is a girl with the main defect mainly on the right side. This right side may look like a spagillian hernia, but this is actually incomplete form of Prune belly syndrome. Investigations, of course, the simple one is to do ultrasound, but many times you have to do, myself, I'm preferring to do ascending cyst urethrogram, as we can see from this picture with ascending cyst urethrogram with the contrast study. We will have a posterior urethral valve or stricture at the urethra, huge dilatation of the ureter, both ureters, but the dilatations may be not symmetrical and more in one side than other side. With we can see also the diverticulum over the dome of the urinary bladder, and this IVB with contrast with subtraction, you can have a huge dilatation of the ureter, of both ureters, with hydronephrosis, and in many cases you have to do MRU as MRI to detect the exact pathology. And of course, we have to do isotope scanning to detect which kidney is sharing in the function and if there is any obstruction or not, and how much the glomerular filtration rate. So surgical management of such children formed of the, as the syndrome is triad, so also the management have three steps. These steps can be taken in one session or in a sequence of session, but we have to start by urinary tract reconstruction, then abdominal wall reconstruction, either combined with orchidopexy or a separate entity, but most of the surgeon, most of the center doing the abdominal wall reconstruction along with orchidopexy at the same setting. But I saw many centers doing the three items together to have the child with adequate aesthetic appearance and to improve his quality of life. A urinary tract reconstruction actually mainly in the form of diversion, different levels of diversion. Many centers, if you have the child presented late with severe obstruction and borderline renal function, you have to do vasicostomy. Sometimes you may have the option to drain the ureter by ureterostomy, and very rarely you may need to have nephrostomy. Posterior urethra, prostate, and the accessory sex organ are affected. Urinary tract abnormality has been historically performed in the about 20 or 30 years ago, most of the center are doing first the re-implantation after tailoring of the ureter, the huge dilated ureter, with re-implantation in the bladder, some surgeon adding a reduction cystoplasty in hope to eliminate the obstruction and to correct the severe vasico-ureteric reflux. Urinary diversion also in some cases, if the family accepts, you can just do a clean intermittent castration through the urethra, or much better is to have a continent channel like a mitrofenof, but complex reconstructive operation involving detrosal placation or creation of overlapping bladder flaps, ureteral tapering and re-implantation. And in severe cases with severe renal affection, you may have the last option to do a renal transplant. This is on the right side, an example of the hugely dilated ureter, the case as you operated by doing tailoring of the ureter, a reconstruction of the ureter with re-implantation. And on the left side, this is a typical example of mitrofenof with stoma and castration. This is maybe a good option for many cases just to save the kidney. Antenatal diagnosis and management, it is in utero intervention in patients, especially with urethral posterior valve or urethral atresia, to decrease the amount of oligohydramnios and to decrease the burden on the lung and to relieve some of the obstruction. You may save the kidney early by doing a vasicosynthesis or vasicoamniotic shunting. I have experience to do this shunting in few cases by a double pigtail catheter. You can insert this catheter early in the first trimester or the second trimester, guided by the ultrasound. It may save some cases or at least decrease the burden of the upper urinary system and decrease also the amount of oligohydramnios, and it may save the lung later on. Some centers have a huge number of cases by doing fetal cystoscope and doing vasico-amniotic shunting. The results actually of antenatal intervention is not so good in many centers. Many cases may be lost after the whole effort to do a sort of shunting, because actually the kidney or the renal affection start early in the first trimester. Abdominoplasty can be done in the first year of life. This is not just only for the appearance of the abdominal wall and for the quality of life, but also it affects the walking, breathing, and good defecation. And abdominoplasty also may improve the urination, so the child will be able to urinate and to defecate normally by the use of a good musculature in the abdominal wall. Placation with complete overlap of the fascia, and the most important for myself, I'm interested with umbilicus and umbilical position. So new umbilicoplasty is essential for this child. And as we will see that the umbilicus usually shifted up, so you may have to have the umbilicus, the native umbilicus itself, to be shifted down, or you may need to have a new flap to create a new umbilicus. This is an example of abdominoplasty. So we can see this child on the left side down. He had the umbilicus shifted up, not in the normal position. So the option here is to discard this native umbilicus and to create a new island umbilicoplasty. But in the other case, on the upper corner, we can use the same umbilical stump and a wide, very wide incision. And it is up to the, as we mentioned, the spectrum of the cases. You may have a good musculature, so just you may do placation, but in some cases you may have no muscles at all, just a fibrous sheet. And in some cases you may have the option to put a mesh after placation and after excision of the excess thin musculatures of the abdominal wall. And you may be lucky to have a good outcome like this one with, I think after 1 year of follow-up, he had a good abdominal wall and good control of the abdomen and more or less an acceptable umbilicus. But this is not the case. Many cases may have a recurrence with the recurrence of the thinning of the abdominal musculatures and atrophic muscles in some cases. And you may have the child again with distension and need to be reoperated. And also in this case, the child is unlucky to have the umbilical stump lost. Orchidopexy, bilateral orchidopexy can done as the same as we are dealing with intra-abdominal testicle. So we can see that both testicles can be grasped. And most of the cases you have a long spermatic cord, so easy for the testicle to be brought down and to do orchidopexy by the end of the abdominoplasty. This is another case. You can see clearly that both testicles with long spermatic cord and very easy to be fixed. And we can see also in this case, we opted to have a new umbilical stump and to discard the native umbilicus. So actually, these cases are coming as a rare genitourinary anomalies, and I have experience with about 15 cases along my career, and I think most of the cases presented by patent urethras. So I have a chapter dedicated mainly for the urethral anomaly and patent urethras in my books, in my book about the umbilicus and umbilical cord. And thank you.